production of Broad and High is funded in part by the Greater Columbus Arts Council, supporting arts, advancing culture, and connecting the community to artists, events, and classes at columbusmakesart.com.
PNC, committed to Central Ohio, for the achiever in you. From these contributing sponsors and viewers like you, thank you.
This time on Broad and High, check out the latest public art sculpture that is lighting up the short north.
It's a pretty significant sculpture. It's about 30 feet up in the air, suspended.
Meet a Columbus artist who is taking wall art to a whole new level, and sample the sound of four local musicians who call themselves old friends. This and more right now on Broad and High.
Hi everyone, welcome to Broad and High. I'm your host, Kate Quickle. If you've driven down High Street lately, you might have noticed a new public art sculpture suspended above the entrance of the White Castle building in the Short North. It's titled Jubilation, and it's a dynamic display of changing light and color, intending to celebrate the ever-changing vibrancy of the neighborhood. Here's more.
So we are here in the Short North Arts District, right at 2nd and High. A lot of folks know this intersection as where you can find North Star and where you can find the White Castle, but now it is an intersection where you can find a remarkable new piece of public art. It is a work by a longtime Columbus artist who has a really incredible reputation here locally, and is really the first time that this particular artist has worked in light with this way. And light is certainly a part of our life here in the Short North. This piece of art in some way pays homage to that, but also the exuberance of everyone that you see here in the Short North.
So I'm a public artist. And the work that I love doing most is site-engendered. For me, that means looking at the site, who's going to be experiencing it, and how do we create a piece? How does my partner, Judith, and I conceptualize a work that's going to resonate with the site and that's going to resonate with the public?
We were very interested in having this piece reflect the joy that is the Short North. And I feel like this piece really reflects that because of the materials and because of the light.
We're now in the fabrication stage. And here we are actually creating the stainless steel structure that supports the sculpture's dichroic panels. Once those pieces are cut out and we can see sections of them, we're then welding them together. We'll sand, finish, polish, and then insert the dichroic films panels. One of the things I love about my work is the collective experience, the collaborative experience. So this project has had on it architects, engineers, lighting designers, the fabricators. There'll be people who will install it. So there are about 20 people involved in this one piece. The central core, which is really going to be enlightening and jazzing it up, are LEDs, programmable RGB LEDs, red, blue, green, that will, through the computer's program, play with different compositions of color and movement.
The piece is totally different daytime than it is in the evening. So depending on when you visit the Short North, and many people visit the Short North both day and night, you can have a completely different experience in viewing the work of art.
What it does is it both reflects light from the ambient light, and then as light passes through it, it's actually a different color. It acts a bit like a prism.
So it's this composition of light, metal, the light playing with the dichroic, the light playing with the RGB LEDs, and the viewer as we walk in front of it, suspended 30 feet in the air.
The people that are under this sculpture are going to be having a light show that's going to be rather hard to avoid. It's going to be reflecting on their phones, and they're going, what is that? And they'll be looking up, because the dichroic material in this sculpture and the LED lights in it are going to be casting this rainbow of color.
This is very new for us in Columbus. This is a work of art that is attached to a building. It's a pretty significant sculpture. It's about 30 feet up in the air suspended. It's about 25 feet long. And unlike other works of public art that we have here in Columbus, which are sort of tactile, where you can touch them and you can see them right in front of your face, this is suspended above you. So how you view it changes depending on how you move around it.
One of my objectives in life, being here as a Columbusite, having our base here, is to bring as much beauty and cultural meaning to the city as we can. We love Columbus. It's a dynamic, vibrant place today. And our contribution gives us a sense of fulfillment as citizens and as public artists in this community.
I think this is going to be a fun piece. I think people will enjoy it.
Just a few streets over in the Short North, a different kind of sculpture is taking shape at the home of Tyshawn Freeman. He started experimenting with fiber sculpture just last year. Using only acrylic yarn and some pushpins, he creates abstract geometric patterns on whatever flat surface he can find.
I am an artist, I guess I would say. You know, I did want to dabble in different things. So I used the pens and grabbed some yarn and just dibbled and dabbled, and ever since I couldn't stop. I'm addicted. You know, I can't creatively, you know, come up with something by sketching and looking at it that way. I kind of just have to do it. It comes out better while I'm doing it versus, you know, premeditated. I'm kind of thinking now if this was a good idea with these colors, but I think I'm gonna make it work and see what happens. My inspiration was roses. You know, if you can maybe get that from like the darker green and the red I used, and try to throw a little pink in there just to, you know, brighten it up a bit. But, you know, I did a bumblebee, which is over there, and a little monster, but I'm really big on the abstract. You know, I just do it. I just do it and I like it, and then, you know, that's all it is, really. Usually with my more random ones, I just pin them and just go along as I, you know, and if I don't like it, take it down, do it over again. I have blisters now, you know, trying to push the pins into the wood because I don't want to hammer them in an apartment complex. Even sometimes with the yarn, I have to wear gloves now, but sometimes with the yarn and the abstracty ones, I get, you know, little burns from the yarns. My arms hurting on the big ones, and it's crazy, yeah. I have to take breaks. You know, I guess it pains for things to come out nice looking, I guess. I'm gonna make them purple. Well, right now I'm using push pins, you know, thumbtacks. I have used nails before, you know, I've just started with these wood palettes. I'm in the beginning stages, so I'm, you know, trying to perfect it in a way where people won't get hurt if they want to take it home. Sometimes I'll take out a push pin, you know, add a push pin, take down, sometimes I'll just take the whole thing down once I'm finished. I'm like, I don't really like it. Look at it from different angles. I'll just take it all down and start all over, so. I just like to see the outcome. Like, I'm really excited to see what the outcome's gonna turn out. You know, something about the texture really brings out the color, and you can really see it a lot better with, you know, maybe a thicker yarn versus a thinner one, or that's why I try to use the thinner lines, you know, with the thicker ones to kind of give it some type of dimension. People have seemed to like them. People have really seemed to like them. I haven't gotten any requests yet, but people have seemed to like them. You know, I'm kind of excited about it. See where this takes me.
Follow along with Tyshawn's artistic journey on Instagram. You can find him and all his yarn creations at Who is Tyshawn. Like most working actors, Central Ohio native Kevin Farrell held random jobs while pursuing a career in Hollywood, where he appeared in small roles in film and television, most notably on Frasier. When a friend encouraged him to sell Tupperware in drag to supplement his income, his alter ego, known as DWI, was born. Dee, a slightly raunchy beauty queen from Tennessee who might have a drinking problem, soon rose the ranks to become Tupperware's number one salesperson in North America. Farrell, who has since relocated to Powell, shares with us the story of his unconventional career path.
DWI is my character to sell Tupperware. Dee's a little trailer trash. She's not very classy. She kind of can talk like a truck driver. Her look is just, it's out there. It's loud and it's out there. I'm like a clown. But she's fun loving and she likes to have a good time. If Susie Hostess says she's having a Tupperware party, chances are all our girlfriends are like, oh, really? You know, I just went to a jewelry party last week and now I gotta go to a clothing party next week. But then when they see the picture of DWI, then all the girls are like, oh my God, you know, I gotta go to that.
I'm how excited! Okay, we'll get started in just a second, y'all. Ooh! Are y'all drinking? Because I'm prettier when you're drunk. Woo!
Her character is from Tennessee, and she was the last sole heir to the Jack Daniels fortune. So she had a little drinking problem. So DWI is really driving while intoxicated.
How fun is that? It's incredible.
So I grew up here in Columbus, Ohio, went to Centennial High School. Then I went to Miami University of Ohio. I worked as an actor for about 10 years in Chicago. I got cast on an episode of Frasier, which took me out to Los Angeles. I played David Hyde Pierce's lookalike on an episode.
Oh, everyone, this is Rodney Banks.
Hello.
Dr. Niles Craig.
How do you do? The pleasure is mine.
So that took me to Los Angeles, and then I started working as an actor pretty nonstop. And then I started selling Tupperware, and it just took off.
Before we get started, I want to do a little survey. Now, how many of us have ever been to a Tupperware party before? Raise your hands. Very good, quite a few of us. Was it a Tupperware party like this? Hell no.
2007 to 2010, I was number one in the nation. So 4 years in a row, I sold more Tupperware than anybody else in the nation.
And then I started making more money doing this than I ever did as an actor. I'm like, well, shoot, I won't live in Hollywood anymore. They have earthquakes and crazy people. So I decided to move home here 2 years ago. So now I'm back and I live in Powell. Woo! Oh my God! I know! I'm a Buckeye.
I think really Tupperware has grown to embrace the drag queen aspect, because there are other guys who sell in drag. I'm not the only one. We are actually bringing Tupperware to a whole new generation of people who don't even know that Tupperware is still around. And we do it with such an entertaining aspect to our show that people just find it more fun.
All right, pickles and cheese, zucchini and carrot, season and serve some fine taste and ferret. Your food has never tasted so fresh to date, right? Okay.
I would say that 95% of the people come to see DWI and then they buy the Tupperware afterwards. Tupperware Corporate is really on board with what we do because we're selling more product than half of their sales force. But there are people who don't understand what I do. And that makes me sad because I'm an actor who dresses up as a character. I come as Kevin, I get dressed up as Dee at your house, and I take Dee off and I leave your house as Kevin because I don't drive around town in drag. And I don't go to the shopping stores as Dee, I don't hang out and go to the zoo as Dee. It is a character that I put on and a character I take off, much like any character in our live play at the theater. The business side of my business is huge because I average 4 to 5 parties a week. So if I'm not working, I'm in my office, I'm calling hostesses to confirm their dates, I'm dating new parties, I'm entering all the orders. Sometimes things don't show up in shipments, so I'm calling, you know, the warehouse to make sure that orders are fulfilled. You know, when I moved to Los Angeles, I thought I was going to be this big-time television actor, I was going to have my own show, I was going to have this huge house in Beverly Hills, and it was all based on being an entertainer. Well, what happened is I got exactly what I wanted, but it just came in a different package, which is amazing.
Come up and touch and feel, the Tupperware included, all right? And
I just wanted to be a paid actor. Now, my paycheck comes from Tupperware. It doesn't come from NBC or CBS or Showtime. I'm selling just as much here as I was in Los Angeles. There is really a need for a drag queen Tupperware lady in Columbus, Ohio. I love the fact that 20-year-olds to 90-year-olds can come to my parties and have a good time. I really just want to entertain people and for them to have a good time.
As I said, my name is DWI, Miss Tennessee. Woo!
The FedEx man is here to deliver Tupperware.
Learn more about Kevin Farrell and his Tupperware alter ego at DWI.com. They can also be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. The members of the latest band to visit the WOSU studio all met in the Columbus neighborhood of Old Town East. These four musicians, who call themselves Old Friends, started jamming together 2 years ago and blend their rhythm and melody to create one harmonious instrumental sound on their song, Friday Night Lights. OLDE FRNDS will be releasing their new vinyl album later this month. They'll be performing on Saturday, May 25th at Ruby Tuesday on Summit Street. Check out the band's Facebook page for times and details. And that is our show. You can find all our stories online at WOSU.org. And of course, give us a follow on social. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We're leaving you today with more music by OLDE FRNDS. For all of us here at WOSU, I'm Kate Quickle. Thanks for watching. I'll see you back here next week with more great stories of Columbus creativity.
I see or hear or read things that interest me all the time.
Whenever inspiration hits, I try to capture it.
It's the power to generate real and lasting social change.
I don't ever give up. Even when I doubt myself, I keep going.
The notes and words come to me from everywhere.
I am blessed to have the trust and freedom to explore with my colleagues. This type of synergy is something very special.
Production of Broad and High is funded in part by the Greater Columbus Arts Council, supporting arts, advancing culture, and connecting the community to artists, events, and classes at columbusmakesart.com.
PNC, committed to Central Ohio, for the achiever in you. From these contributing sponsors and viewers like you, thank you.